Recording powers activated. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, wow, you're right on time, and you're correct.
Which one of us?
I don't know. I'm not sure who's thinking that.
Who's thinking what? Because we're both on time, which is both unusual.
It is true.
Maybe our listeners are thinking that. No, they don't know our recording schedule.
Right. Or our personal habits. Although they know a lot more of our personal habits if they've been listening.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean, Chris knows everything about us.
He knows too much.
He does know too much. We've been thinking very seriously about eliminating him. I mean, look, we can't have too many listeners. Now, you look all dolled up this evening, Sarah. Have you been doing something special?
No, sometimes I like to look intimidating on the weekend.
I understand. Sometimes you need to look good for this podcast.
That's right. Ermac went to the vet on Friday.
Yeah.
And he weighs 165 pounds.
Jesus, Mary and Joseph. It's a big dog.
The vet was like, he's gained some weight. Are you feeding him more? And I said, no, thank you. He's big boned.
He grew all on his own.
Yeah. Well, it's
Plus
winter.
He gets into stuff, you know? You don't control everything he eats.
Well, I fucking try. Let's put it that way.
Well, he does better than Moose. Moose is into cake and, you know, whatever. Opens the fridge, gets himself out a sandwich, makes it up.
You joke, but
no,
yeah.
I don't. Yeah, he does that. I know he does that. I know he fries himself up some eggs. Gets ash in them from his cigarette dangling from his jaw.
Uh-huh.
Or his snout, really.
Clenched in his teeth.
Right, as he's flipping those eggs with his little paws.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the reasons Moose is in such poor health. He's got too high cholesterol. Is it cold there in the undisclosed location?
It's really nice today.
Yeah, it's really nice today.
Oh, was it? Okay, you just, you know, Sarah, you're bundled up in a blanket. Nick, you're wearing a hood.
It's chilly in the sub-basement.
I understand. Yeah, well, that's true. Makes
sense. In the maintenance sector of the sub-basement facility.
Right, of the bomb shelter. Well, so shall we begin?
Let's do it.
Okay, let's do it indeed. Welcome to A Shin Show. I'm your host, Pete Shin, from an undisclosed location on the East Coast in a sound booth there. Joining me from an undisclosed location in the Midwest, beneath a bunker in a sub-basement, somewhere underneath a cornfield, is son Nick and daughter Sarah. Hello, Nicholas and Sarah.
Howdy.
All right.
Howdy. The thing that we're under changes weekly, just for the listeners out there. Sometimes it's a cornfield, sometimes it's a mall, a strip mall. Sometimes it's a complex, some kind of apartment.
I don't want them to know where I am.
Okay.
Yeah, that's why it changes on the regs.
Why would you point it out?
Well, the nature of its changes is such that, you know, it's kind of like that island in Pirates of the Caribbean.
Hashtag catch me if you can.
Tortuga, I think, is what it was called, right?
Yeah.
Can't find it unless you already know where it is.
True or false, I've been to Tortuga Beach.
True.
It is true because it's in Ecuador. It's in
you know how I knew it was true?
Why?
Because true or false, all of your true or false questions are true.
That's false. So there you go.
Okay. True or false, 99% of your true or false questions are true.
That is true.
Okay.
I think. No, actually, mostly they're false.
I mean, I don't have an exact percentile. No, every time you're like, true or false, I did this once. I'm like, well, obviously it's true. Because it always
is. The game is true or false, and then it's false, right? So true or false. Jim Morrison actually, at one time, met JFK, and they got high. True or false?
False.
No, that's true.
God damn it.
You broke your own rule.
I just figured, you know, he was thinking about it like he was thinking of some shit, and he said, how do you know JFK got high with Jim Morrison?
Oh, well, I know things. I've got a security clearance.
Okay.
I don't know that.
What if he did not inhale those drugs?
Well, that's Bill Clinton. I may be mistaking JFK for Bill Clinton in this. In fact, I'm sure I am. Yeah, it's Bill Clinton. That's what I meant. All right.
Really?
No.
Are you serious? You confuse those two?
I don't know, but why? Remember when you were doing it from the upstairs, how much better it sounded?
Yeah.
Why are you not doing it from up there?
Well, Murph may be working up there, doing some things up there.
I see.
So this is, I could go in the other room though, like in the thing? You think that would make a difference?
It would make a difference. I'm sure of it. Because you can't wear both headphones. You've still got this overlapping thing. You're sounding in Sarah's mic and your own mic.
Go to my dressing room, open the drawer, clamp the mic there. It'll be nice and muffled because I have all kinds of clothes. Sandy's room.
Oh, okay. Okay, stand by.
Dressing room, nay, Sandy's room.
Yeah, okay. So this is a separate, obviously, separate undisclosed location.
Yeah, this is another sector in the facility. The dressing room is in the executive sector.
Yes, of course. I mean, when you're talking about the sub-basement of a bomb shelter, I mean, you've got a lot.
I don't know if bomb shelter is the right word. I'd call it less of a bomb shelter and more of a, you know, just a facility.
Oh, well, yeah, I think that's fair. I mean, there's a lot that goes on
between these rooms, so I'm not.
Between the bioweapons research and then the, I don't know what all you do. Probably, well, I mean, obviously the piece where you're doing experiments on Ermac and Moose. I mean, there's a whole separate thing for animal experiments. I know that. In fact, the word is that coronavirus escaped from your facility.
That's not been confirmed.
But it hasn't been denied.
I don't know if you're allowed to give your genuine opinion on this, but what I want to hear what you think the odds are. By the way, do I sound better?
Oh, you sound 1,000% better. Surprise. Okay.
Let's see if I can.
Open the drawer.
Well, I'm fascinated once you figure out your life there. And by the way, good job of getting up there without any, totally seamless, by the way. Completely seamless.
Thank you. I tried. I tried hard on that.
Yeah, you did really, really well.
Also, I upgraded my Wi-Fi, so.
Oh, man, between those two things, we're sounding like butter. Just like butter. Yeah, we started, but, you know, we can stop. Elsie's here. When we need to stop and move a chair into the undisclosed sound booth.
Undisclosed and nondescript.
Yeah. Oh, Jesus, it's heavy. Oh, my God. Ouch. It hurts us.
I like how he has turned now into a 90-year-old Jewish grandmother.
Yeah, it was very womanly. Oh, my God, it's so heavy.
It hurts. It hurts, it's precious.
Okay, maybe I should.
All right, it's partially in.
Just led with that.
I don't think it goes in there. Oh, Jesus. Oh, jeez. I put the wrong. Oh, Christ. Oh, that hurt.
You didn't stop the recording, did you?
Well, that
didn't work out for me.
Ow. Did you stop recording?
No, not at all.
Okay.
We caught all that. And we're going to try this one now.
Okay, here we go. Oh, this is so much better. Oh, this is lighter than air. This is like... How did I ever get a goddamn...
I swear to almighty Krishna Vishnu, I'm going to get this goddamn microphone stand to cooperate with me.
There. Okay, so I'm gonna be in position like this for the remainder of the pod. I think it'll be fine.
Okay, so anyway, here's my fucking question. My question is, all right, we got a little off track there, but the question is, what are the odds, do you think, that the coronavirus is in, was manufactured?
I think the odds are pretty goddamn good, actually. I've read some stories on this, and it does seem to suggest that the Chinese government is, well, for one thing, they have their only bioweapons grade facility
is in Wuhan. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Now, I'm sure that's just a coincidence.
Right.
But the reality is that it's probably not a coincidence.
Yeah.
So I think the odds are pretty good the coronavirus did not originate from your location, but rather from the Chinese location.
Now, do you think that was an intentional thing? That
absolutely not. I do not think it was an intentional thing, because it's cost the Chinese billions and billions of dollars and has basically shut down a quarter of their economy. It's a big concern for our own economy, actually.
Right. Well, there's this girl who works at China Buffet who went over there to visit her family and hasn't come back. They won't let her come back. Although the owners go to China all the time and they come back no fucking problem. But they're probably A-class citizens, you know, because they own a business in America, is what I think.
Have they left and come back since the outbreak?
Yeah.
Yes. Must be a different province that or province that they're visiting.
Yeah, probably. China's a big place.
It really is.
China.
And as you point out, not all Chinese are treated equally.
Yeah, yeah. I feel like that probably has at least some factor in their ability to travel to and from these countries so easily and so frequently.
Well, in China, to quote George Orwell in Animal Farm, everyone is equal. It's just that some are more equal than others.
You're right. Quite. Yeah. Well, they do that thing, that social system thing, you know, where like if you fuck up or you commit whatever a crime is in the eyes of the Chinese government, then your social stat, you're like a B-class citizen now, or C-class or D-class. And depending on how low you are on the ladder, you know, you can't get loans, you can't live in certain places, can't travel certain places. You know, but I would imagine that if you are a citizen in China, but also a citizen in America, and you own a business in America, that it would be pretty hard for you to not be at the top of the ladder in the social system in China. But I really don't know.
I don't know either. We'll have to consult some of our Chinese allies, which we have none.
Yeah, of which there are none.
Although you, it does kind of suggest that you are a security risk that you work at a Chinese restaurant.
Yeah, I would think that.
It's a perfect cover, slinging that low man.
Yeah, slinging it like high lie.
How's things going at the job, Nick?
It's fine, you know.
Yeah. What about your insane maintenance man? Any update there?
Oh no, I haven't seen him around in a while. I'm sure he's, you know, in some sort of incarceration for some sort of terroristic threat. That's his MO.
It's what he do.
His raps, yeah. That's what the maintenance men do, is acquire charges for terroristic threats.
And then just, go get bailed out by his Chinese bosses and just go back to work as if nothing happened.
Right. But not before distributing manifestos to everyone in the workplace.
Which you have still not gotten a copy of.
Ah, it's fucking gone now, dude. Dumb bitch threw it away.
Don't worry. He'll be back with another manifesto, I feel confident.
Yeah, of a different, but that one, the one that I saw, that was like prime example. That's something like you would give a psychiatrist and be like, yeah, hey, just so you know, this guy right here wrote this. So keep that in mind.
Right, and then you'd hiccup because you're drunk when you give it to the psychiatrist.
Right.
Yes. Yeah, I have gaseous issues. I always, you know, I'm always hiccuping and burping, farting,
you know,
out of my eyes.
Yeah, you know what I trace it to?
What?
When you were an infant, okay, you were just an infant, we gave you formula with iron in it. And that, and it plugged up your butthole. Okay. Real bad.
Okay.
And so at one point, your beloved mother and I had to take you to the emergency room in Nebraska City, and the doctor had to stick his finger up your butt to clear it out of these iron poops.
Mm-hmm.
And you've never pooped right since. You've had intestinal issues ever since. That's what I attribute it to.
May iron I poops sounds like some sort of like power move, or you know, just some sort of weaponized
a thing. Special attack.
But yeah.
I also need to understand. Did you all try suppositories before taking to the emergency room and the finger situation?
Yeah, the suppository was the doctor's finger.
I'm just saying, a little glycerin does the job.
Yeah, I'm just telling you right now, man. They tried all that shit in the emergency room, and eventually, like, yeah, I got to go in.
I gotta go in. Yeah, I'm sure that's yes. Oh, sure. We ran all the tests possible. I'm just gonna have to stick my finger in your kid's ass. That's the only way. So, are you really? You were back there for 5 minutes. Yep, ran all the tests. Gotta go with the finger in the ass. Hey, I'm a doctor. Okay. Who's the doctor here? Me.
You could have just taken him to Council Bluffs.
Well, I'm not sure it was.
Thank God you didn't do that.
Yeah,
Council
exactly.
Tucky? Are you shitting me? I would never, although I always have this thing where like, I'm always like, and it's been like this my whole life where I'm like about to throw up all the time. Like something will always try, is always trying to come up and I have to walk with my head to the side to like pinch off my throat. People are all the time. People ask me like, why are you fucking holding your head like that? And then I got to wait till it passes. All the time. Like several times a day.
Is your head a Pez dispenser and just like keeping it on the side?
I have to keep my head. I don't know if you guys can see, but I have to keep it like this all the time. Like, because something will happen. It's like more than, it's like a burp plus one.
What is wrong with you?
I don't know, but it's been like that forever. People be like, why are you looking at me? Why are you fucking with your head cocked to the side? And I have to be like, I have to do that. for the next however many seconds so I don't throw up, because I'll just throw up if I don't.
I understand.
Well, like no always. One understands.
It all goes back to that iron formula. I'm telling you right now. Fuck you up permanently.
Yeah, maybe. It's not so bad, though. I live
never the same after a finger in your butt.
Yeah. Well,
not true.
For better or for worse?
Yeah, because they, you know, sometimes doctors just do that. I see you have a cold. Drop your trousers, yeah. Please.
Looks like I'm going to have to enter you for our checkup.
Don't worry. I'm a doctor.
Is this really a medical procedure? Hey, that's for a jury to decide later. Now bend over, please. And then you're like, what? And then you get the fucking mask on your face. Count backwards from 10. You wake up with your shirt on backwards and your fucking pants around your ankles. Well, that's a $5,000 invoice.
Yeah, that's how it happens to me anyway. And it sounds like to you too. So
it's all part of the experience, you know?
Yep.
So, Sarah, our listeners can't see you, but you look super cute and all dolled up. Is there a story?
No, sometimes a bitch just has to look cute.
Fair enough.
When she cleans her house.
Right. Well, we know all about that.
Look, so, I know y'all can't, you don't have the full picture, but I also have some super cute floral death tights on, and I had some combat boots on earlier, so I had a whole look, capital L.
Floral Ooh. Death tights.
Yep.
I like that. That sounds like a band.
I've decided that my style is heavy metal grandma.
Okay.
I like nice. That.
Floral prints with skulls and big sweaters and black and pink. Yeah.
Very cute.
Nice. Super so how was grandma. Kansas City last weekend?
Kansas City was good. Ate a shitload of food, did some shopping, ate some more, drove back, did and some illegal speed breaking things, and that was fun, and we what all had a good time.
What do you mean illegal speed breaking things? Did you mean you were driving down the road at 85 miles an hour and grabbed the e-brake and then it went into a Tokyo Drift type situation?
We'll say it's 85, yeah.
Yeah, that's yeah.
Okay. Tokyo Drift, Kansas City style.
There was a Camaro, a very fast Camaro that we kept up with for a while, so
in the Chrysler 300?
No, in the Challenger.
Oh, I
see.
In
the fucking 375 horsepower Challenger that goes from 0 to 60 in like I'm pretty sure it's 375, but
yeah, but probably actually.
Because we were just talking about this last night. But yeah, it goes from 0 to 60. And I think the record on the little game in the fucking speedometer is 5.3 seconds.
That's pretty quick.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, that sounds fun. I'm glad you had a good weekend. Nick, I know that you fixed a Jeep today. How'd the Jeep fixing go?
Nope. I didn't do shit. I just sat there and watched Bubba do his thing.
Okay, you bubble wrangled.
See, when I say that I'm doing anything with any car, what that means is that I'm standing 3 feet away from Bubba watching him do the thing that I said that I'm doing.
Right.
He does it all.
And you're providing him cigarettes, obviously.
Here's no.
Emotional support animal.
No, he's, well, yeah. Yeah, emotional support animal for sure. Sarah compared me to a nurse, and I was like, fuck no, I do not. I hand him things sometimes, but a dog could do that too.
So. Yeah, I think so. Yeah, Elsie's entirely correct. In emotional for sure. Support animal. By the way, Elsie has joined us, just FYI. Yeah, and you're right. We're not going to restart it.
She's been talking this whole time.
Yeah.
Why would you say that she... Are you okay?
No,
you having a stroke,
before.
Dude? I mean, she's been talking for, like, since 10 minutes ago. Why would you now shoehorn the fact that she joined us?
Well, I couldn't remember if I'd introduced her or not.
No, what? I will say that I'm sorry I'm late.
Not computing.
But an emergency arose, and only one superhero could stop it, and that would be the laundry folder. It's not the hero you need. It's not the hero you want. It's the hero you need.
That's definitely the hero I need. Well done.
Yeah, our black and orange cat was about to lay on a newly out of the dryer load
no!
of whites, and the last thing we need is black cat hair in our underwear.
No one needs that. I mean, there's certain
I mean, is
fetishes.
That the last thing you need, really?
It's one of the last things, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
It's not a top-tier thing we need.
No, definitely not.
Certainly not. So in our personal news, we bought some furniture. This is the furniture. Remember, we're going to have a whole episode devoted to describing
furniture. Oh, yeah, but we just talk about furniture?
Yeah.
Yeah, the furniture circle jerk.
It's furniture circle jerk.
Yeah, I've been waiting.
Anyway, so yeah, we bought some dressers, a couple of dressers, mid-century dressers, and we had to clean up, you know, put a little, you know, put a little orange glow on them, you know, vacuum out the filth, scrape off some of the what looked like boogers on the inside of them, and they're good as new.
Vacuum out the filth.
Yeah. So then we, you know, got them moved in, and now our bedroom no longer looks like a dorm room. So we're pretty excited about that. And that's our personal news.
And how long?
So my personal news, which is separate because we're not the same person, although that's good news. We're very excited about that. Brad took me to go see Saint Motel as a birthday gift. So it was the most fun show I've ever been to, and I've been to countless shows. Great time. If you haven't been, you should check them out.
They are coming to Kansas City.
Oh, you should people.
Soon-ish, so.
Definitely go.
I might.
You should, apparently. Do you either?
I was thinking about it, so, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
That might just be what puts me over the edge.
For sure.
Well, I'll tell you what. When Elsie says it's the best show she's ever seen, she's saying something because she's seen Pearl Jam at least half a dozen times. She's seen, give them some other acts that you've seen.
Jack White and multiple festivals and back in Cage the Elephant a few times, Fiona Apple, Ben Harper, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, not the point. And not necessarily the best show, just the most fun show.
Well, that's an interesting distinction.
There's some personal news for me is that I bought tickets to Riot Fest, which is in Chicago in September because My Chemical Romance is headlining.
Oh,
and
I thought
I'm
they were
super
disbanded.
Excited about that. They were. This is the reunion tour.
Ooh.
So it would be as if I went and saw The Who, as if Entwistle and Keith Moon came back from the dead, and then I went and saw The Who. That's what it's like.
Yeah.
Except My Chemical Romance. No one in the band died, right?
No. No, they just all went to rehab, had some kids.
Oh, great.
Your aesthetic should be perfect for the show.
I'm saying. Well, I need, you know, heavier eyeliner or something. It's a little more emo than heavy metal. I guess I could go with emo grandma. I don't know.
Get there.
We'll work out the kinks later.
Sounds like you've got till September.
Yes.
Well, congratulations on getting those tickets. Well done indeed. I think you'll enjoy that. So that does bring up a good question though, which is if Elsie says that Saint Motel is the most fun show she's ever been to, what would you say is the most fun show you've ever been to?
And this applies to you too, Nick, because we go to totally different kinds of shows.
Most of the shows I've ever been to were with you, Sarah. So.
Oh, well, okay. Well, one of the most fun was my first brand new concert. And that's because it had been like 10 years since they were touring in between their tours. So everyone who was there was like, you know, there was like a sense of community there. Everybody was super happy. That was really cool. And it was also my first time seeing them. So that made an impression.
And they're called Brand New?
Mm-hmm.
That's odd. I've never heard of them. So they're brand new to me, obviously.
There you go. They fit the name.
Didn't they break up? Line.
Yeah, they did.
It was just two guys, right?
No.
Okay.
Well, there were two guys in it, but they weren't the only two guys.
Correct.
Okay. Yeah. Three guys?
I think there's four of them.
Okay.
But there's certainly not seven.
No. That's Maroon 5 territory, and we don't
seven
go there.
Is right out.
It's right out.
Seven is right out.
All right, so you're saying Brand New. And Nick, how about you? Funnest show you've ever been to?
Oh.
Wait.
Go ahead.
No, you go first, Sarah. You have a deeper well of experiences for this one.
Well, here's one of the weirdest shows I've ever been to. Weirdest / most fun. And that's Cake. We went to Cake back in the day, way back in the day, and they gave away a tree in the middle of their set.
Yeah. I was there. Yeah, awesome. I was there for that. Yeah. I really wanted that tree.
Yeah, but none of us could fucking decide what kind of tree it was. We went through the crowd. He's like, whoever can name this kind of tree gets it.
Oh, that
and
is
I
what
swear
it was,
to God,
yeah.
The crowd went through like 17 different types of tree before he was like, some kid got it. It was a cherry tree. And I'm like, we're from Apple Country, you dick. What do you want from us?
Yeah, I also remember I have a distinct memory of him like, you know, the song would be playing and then he would go to drink the beer on the stool, but that's when he was supposed to come in. So he would have to like throw the beer down real quick and then he'd be a little late sometimes on the But it was, you know, it was fun. It was still a good performance. It wasn't like he was trashed. But
yeah, I saw Cake in Kansas City about 15 years ago. They were quite good. I enjoyed them. But I would have to say the funnest show I ever went to, it's, I have a pretty deep well of experience also, but it was 1986, and I saw The Grateful Dead, which was the opening act, followed by Tom Petty, and then Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers stayed on and were the backup for Bob Dylan.
Wow.
That was a pretty damn good show.
That's a pretty legendary show.
It was legendary.
And you can't do that. That does not exist to this day.
No, they closed the show with Knock, Knock, Knocking on Heaven's Door. And they opened the show, The Grateful Dead did, with a version of Give Me Some Lovin'.
Nice.
Yeah. And everything in between, I can't recall.
Right. Right.
Because it was that kind of show.
Yeah. Who would? Who would?
Actually, I do remember a few other highlights. But yeah, one of them was Tom Petty singing, You Don't Have to Live Like a Refugee. Don't have to live like a refugee.
Yeah, it's not one of his good ones.
You don't think that's one of his good ones? One of his best?
No,
yeah,
it's one of it. It's like, it's okay, but it's like not the best. That's a purely, you know, opinion. It's not a, it's just he's got better songs to me. They sound better. You know what I mean? Some people might like that song. Those people are wrong. It's okay, you know?
Exactly. What was the most fun show for you, Nick?
The funnest show was actually probably that WAC show I went to, the most recent one. Cause like it was at a fucking bar. Like I was right there. The dude was like talking to me and shit. Like, you know, I feel like 10 years from now, this dude's going to be in arenas. You know what I mean? And also UBI, Ubiquitous from Cess Crew, was there with him. He like was on right before him. And Ubiquitous is, I know I said all this already, but Ubiquitous got money. Like, there's a big theater across the street from this little shitty bar they're playing in. And he's like, yeah, I did the bourbon like 9 or 10 times. Like, they, you know, it was crazy to be that close to Ubiquitous too. Like, I was right there, feet away from him. Taylor actually gave him a fucking hair tie. His hair was all fucked up. He's like, I'm not gonna lie, guys, usually I wear a hat and shit, and my hair is looking whack right now. And then Taylor like held up a hair tie. He handed her the mic to hold on to. He put his hair up. It was like, boom, you're a lifesaver. And she's like, ah, that was so cool. I'm like, you don't even know how fucking cool that was. That guy was, this dude is so talented. He put on such a great show. And, you know, we were fucking jumping and screaming. And I was like considering not going to that show.
But aren't you glad you did?
So glad I did. And then I was,
Okay, now here's my runner-up show. Would you like to? And I have a few, but my runner-up show, the one that first came to mind was I saw the Police on their Synchronicity tour in 1983 in Oklahoma City. And that was a great fucking show. Absolutely great show. I saw them 25 years later, and it also was a great show, but it was a lot more controlled and contained, a lot less rock and roll, more of a fan service show. And it was about 5 times more expensive. But the show in 83, I mean, everybody was into it. I mean, the show in 2008, you couldn't even smoke a cigarette. You couldn't actually leave your seat. You know what I'm saying? If you actually started dancing in the aisle, security would come and tase you.
Jesus fucking Christ, dude. What's the point?
Yeah. So, 83, people were doing whatever.
Right.
Different.
Yeah. You can't do concerts like that anymore.
No, you can't. It's not a lot. It's actually literally criminal.
Well, you can at festivals. That still happens in festivals, which I did not know.
I've not been to a festival, actually.
It was a fucking, that shit was a game changer. When the first festival I went to, I was like 19 or 20, maybe 19. I just didn't know like that you could
see that's why I wanted your perspective on it, because you've been to more festivals than I have. That's
those were fun. I just didn't know who was playing. Euphorchestra, I saw them, but also I was like, you know, on 2 or 3 different kinds of psychedelics at once, like while it was going on. So, you know, that obviously enhanced the experience. I mean, we boogied for hours, but it was fucking, and it was really good. I still like Euphorchestra to this day. And Mouth, that band Mouth, who just came up there. Dude, we were dancing probably for like 2 hours. I went there with my buddy Wes and Dave and a few other people. But Wes was like, I'm here to see Mouth, dude. There's this crazy band. It's just two dudes. Like, I saw them at this festival years ago. They're fucking killer. We got to go see them. So we go up to where they're at. And it was like probably all in all a 4 or 5 hour jam sesh. Like, just these two dudes, like, and they were just fucking killing it. And, like, I remember just dancing with Wes on, like, after, like, an hour and a half. And, like, they would keep, like, the guitar riff would come down. Like, you would think it's coming, like, slowing down to the end of the song. And then he would just fucking keep going, like, and then he did that. It kind of came to a lull, and I was like, oh, man, is he done? And then they started playing the fucking Cantina song from Star Wars, dude, on the guitar.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, dude. And then the boogie started 2.0, you know what I mean? That was crazy. That was fun as fuck. I forgot about that.
I'm glad we had this conversation earlier.
Yeah.
Look, the only festival I went to, I got pneumonia after I went. So that's been my festival experience.
That was traumatizing.
Yeah, it wasn't the bands. It was just the fact that there's like this open field where people just openly consume, buy and sell drugs with no repercussions. You know what I mean? I didn't know you could do that.
I don't think you're supposed to. I mean, I'm no lawyer.
Well, but here's the thing.
I've been to festivals not seen that.
Yeah, well, here's the thing is that those festivals, especially the ones around here in Nebraska, are held on private property. So, like, some dude owns the fucking thing. He hires bouncers, and he's like, only people who pay can come in here, period, and paramedics if you need them. So, like, it's not legal, but, you know, no one's gonna do anything because you just, that's what you do there, which it sounds crazy, I know, but you just walk in there, and that's what's happening, and it just happens all the time, every year. Like,
well, you be careful out there, okay?
Well, I don't go to those anymore because Well, I mean, I would, but, you know, I just don't.
Yeah. Well, you have responsibilities now. Yeah. I mean, you've got a significant other. You've got two cars that don't work.
Shit,
you've got a cat who's depending on you.
Yeah, two cars.
Yeah, I do have a cat. The one fucking car does work. Thank you very much. works fucking awesome. Like a dream, always.
The Honda, yeah.
Yeah, it's just, you know why? Because it's a Honda.
Yeah, and because of Bubba's ministrations.
Definitely. Which are made in a degree, a magnitude of order easier because it's a Honda.
Right. Got it. Well, that's great. Well, I'm glad we talked over through the... So it does sound to me, though, that Nick, the funnest show you ever went to that was not like a festival was the last show you went to. And the same is true for Elsie.
Yeah. Yeah. I guess you're right.
So, in other news, big primary cycle again this week. Bernie Sanders won again. What do you all think? When is your primary? Is it coming up? And who are you going to vote for? If you feel like saying.
You don't have to share that, by the way. I know we've kind of steered clear of politics, but it is now a fact that Bernie Sanders has won the popular vote in the first three Democrat primaries that have been held.
Well, that's cool. Here's the thing is I'm super uneducated. I'm super uninformed.
Nick votes for whoever I tell him to vote for.
That's cool.
Pretty much.
Yeah, it's cool in this situation, but there's a lot of other people just like me who vote for whoever they get told to vote for, and it's a problem. I at least know that I'm completely 100% uninformed. You know what I mean? I don't like, if someone's like, so you like Bernie Sanders? And I'd be like, yeah. And they'd be like, why exactly? Actually, I do have a couple of reasons why Bernie Sanders is a cool dude. Mainly because there's like pictures of him in the 60s, back before it was cool to be like, you know, all affirmative action and shit. He was doing it, you know, since day one, getting arrested for civil rights and shit. That's pretty cool, you know? That seems like a cool dude.
Plus, he's always had the same hair.
Yeah. You know who's goddamn insane?
Who?
Joe Biden, bro. You can just see his assistants put their fucking head in their hands every time he goes off script and he just says something that was not written by one of his speechwriters. You can just see his posse in the back being like, no, fuck. And then he just goes on some insane tangent. Have you seen those videos of him being like, yeah, you know, I used to hang out with little kids and my hair on my legs was long, and they would run their hand through the hair on my legs in the pool.
I'm sure that's not what he
so
said.
I know.
That's exactly
you,
what he
do
said.
Do you want to bet?
Video.
Yeah, he really? Says that, oh, yeah. word for really? Word. And then after that, he says, yeah, they would run their hand through my hair, and so I know about cockroaches. I know about these things. Dude, complete nonsense.
Oh, my God.
Oh, yeah. Nonsense.
Yeah. Wow, I wonder if he's on drugs at the time.
No.
He's just insane. He's a senile old man.
Yeah, he's just rambling. I mean, yeah, literally, he's just like, fucking rambling. I saw that on Reddit. I couldn't believe it.
Yeah, dude. Yeah. You see, Elsie, you didn't even believe, you thought I was making that shit up. That, but it's true.
That's how. I thought you were making that shit up. I'm Googling it right now.
Oh, yeah.
Google it, dude. Yeah.
You got to peep that. It's
insane.
It's
and then
insane.
I saw this other video. There's this guy, Vic Berger, who used to, I don't know if you've ever seen the Super Deluxe videos. They would make like these weird parodied fucking edited videos of Trump and a bunch of people.
You know, Reverend I have heard of them.
Yeah, Reverend Jim Baker, a bunch of those on him. Fucking just questionable people, you know? They just edit it. And there's one, this dude, but then Super Deluxe got, like, sued or something and disbanded, whatever. But the guy who did all that shit, Vic Berger, he's got his own YouTube channel. And he just makes, like, dude, there's this video he made of Joe. Like, he just compiled all the times Joe Biden was, like, really, really, really touchy-feely with young girls, then it would be like, okay, he does it one time, and you're like, okay, well, that could have been an accident. Two, three times in a row, you're like, dude, what are you doing? And then it would, like, cut to him being like, there's been some, you know, talk about me being too, you know, touchy with people. I like to grab people. I like to pat them on the shoulder. And then it would just cut to him, like, sniffing a little girl and, like, grabbing her head and shit. So creepy, dude. Joe Biden is insane in the membrane. He's Uncle Touchy, too.
Yeah, that is true. Unsolicited hugs. I don't think he means anything by it. I think he's just ignorant of how creepy he is.
That's what I thought. I thought that, too, Elsie. I really did. I could send you the link to this video. Just watch. I will. I'm going to send you the link to this video and just watch it and tell me what you think after that.
Send it to the group.
I will. Yeah. Okay, I will.
All right. So, yeah, we agree that Joe Biden is nuttier than a fucking fruitcake.
Yeah. Yeah. Nuttier than squirrel shit. Okay.
And that's so nutty.
God bless him. Nice guy. And, well, I don't know. I really don't know. I just know he's fucking crazy. Okay.
That much we can all agree on.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, Sarah.
I was just going to say that, you know, at the end of Obama's era, there was all those sad Biden memes, and I fucking loved all of them. So that's still currently my picture in Murphy's phone is sad Biden. And so the fact that he's totally fucking crazy, you know what? Doesn't actually deter me any from her having it as my profile picture. Her phone.
That's fine.
Watch this video I'm talking about, dude. You'll think twice. I'm not exaggerating here, dude.
No, I know.
But you're not voting for Biden, are you, Sarah?
No, I'm voting for whoever Sarah tells me to vote for. If you were asking
our to answer your question, Elsie, our primaries are May 12th. We will be voting either for Warren or Bernie. I haven't decided yet.
Oh, same. I'm in the same exact boat.
I will tell you that by May 12th, it's entirely possible that Elizabeth Warren may no longer be in the race.
Correct. So,
or if she is, she may be, at that point, Biden's VP.
That'd be fine, too.
And ultimately, you know, ultimately, it doesn't fucking matter because I will vote for whoever the Democratic goddamn nominee is.
Even if it's Mayor Pete?
Probably.
Even if it's...
You don't vote, you're voting for the other side, right? So fuck it.
Even if it's Mike Bloomberg?
Man, fuck that guy.
Yeah. I mean, it's not going to happen, so it's easy to say yes to because also just not Trump in my...
Yeah, what's the alternative?
Hey, you know what, though? Let's. I'm going to go with a counterfactual here. Let's talk about President Trump as why you would vote for him. Number one, the economy has been strong. Now, you can say, well, he's just, you know, carried over from Obama. But the fact is that he has stimulated the economy like a Democrat. He has run up deficits like no one's business. $1 trillion a year, basically every year since he's been in office, that stimulus has done wonders for economic growth in this country, number one. Number two, we have not had a single terrorist attack under his watch. And so as a result, you could say, well, his actions against Soleimani, his actions against Baghdadi, his actions against other terrorists, while in some cases unilateral, have been effective in preventing attacks on our homeland. Number three, he has oftentimes
at the express dismay of his advisors, pulled troops out of foreign countries, which is indeed what he promised to do. And he's trying to wind down the war in Afghanistan in a much more substantive way than any of his predecessors. Number five, he has taken on China and has done something about their predatory trade practices. Now, you may disagree with how he's done that, but the fact is that that's something that he promised and something that he followed up on. And then finally, I would just suggest to you that President Trump, in terms of keeping his promises, has appointed extremely conservative judges. So if you're into conservative judges, he has fulfilled that promise. And then finally, he has undoubtedly done more to deregulate the economy than just about any president, well, ever, frankly.
Do you know me at all?
I do. I'm just saying that there is an argument to be made for Trump, and you better believe that President Trump is going to make exactly that argument, and it will bring more along than 39%. So
yeah,
will it bring along
49%?
Will it bring along 48%? Will it bring along 51%? It's hard to say.
That's a perfect segue into anything else.
Yeah, here's the thing is that all that shit that he promised to do and then did, I don't want him to do, which is why I'll be voting Democrat. Thank you.
Okay. Well, there you have it. This is why we avoid talking politics on this podcast.
Is it? We're all pretty Democratic.
Yeah. We've never not all been. Somebody's worried about our demographics and our listeners. I say, fuck you guys. If you don't agree with us, and don't listen. I don't care.
Well, I mean, here's the thing is that I live in a very red state and I work for a super red employer and I still believe in blue. So, you know, don't, if you don't surround yourself by the only people, you know, if you're not in an echo chamber, then you'll make smart decisions is all I'm saying.
And agreed.
And I'm still blue.
Okay, very good. But that is why in the idea on the notion of not living in an echo chamber, that's why I ran down all of those.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. You did good. You did good.
Thank you,
Keith.
Yeah, you represented the other side very well.
Thank you.
Let us never speak of it again.
Thank you.
Let's move on.
So do we think that Nicholas is going to come back or is that just it for him?
No, he'll be back.
Okay. All right, good. Well, let's move on from the political, shall we, into sports. Did you watch that Wilder Fury fight last night?
I didn't. Nick might have. He went to a buddy's house. So we watched the UFC fights, which happened before the Wilder Fury fight. And then he took off to his buddy's house to, I think, watch it. So long answer short, no, I didn't.
Well,
but Nick
so
might have.
The long answer short is Tyson Fury destroyed Wilder. Destroyed him.
Didn't his team throw the towel in for him?
They had to. He ruptured his eardrum in the second round.
Ouch.
Oh, Jesus.
Not only ouch, but, you know, your balance is shot after your eardrum is ruptured. When your ear is bleeding out of its ear hole, chances are your balance isn't going to be that good from that point forward. So,
yeah.
Let's hear it for Tyson Fury, pound for pound, arguably one of the best fighters in the world right now. Certainly the most fearsome heavyweight, potentially, since Mike Tyson.
There you have it.
And there it is. Were the UFC fights any good?
Yeah, they were pretty good. The main card was Paul Felder versus Dan Hooker, which was a talked up match, and we really like Felder, but he lost a decision, and that was sad.
I'm so sorry. Was it?
It was a good fight. It was a five rounder, and they went the distance, and it was a pretty good fight. It was close. It was close.
I might have to watch that fight on ESPN Plus. I like watching it afterwards because you can skip through the commercials and shit like that.
Yeah, that is nice.
Yeah, it really is. It's one of the benefits of ESPN Plus. Yeah. I'll be renewing that subscription, even though I don't watch it as much as I could. Because meditation takes up a lot of my time now.
Oh, does it? So that's going well for you?
Well, I took a 10-day pause, but I'm back at it now.
Good.
Yeah.
Good for you.
Good for my mental health, which, as you know, is on the fraying, ragged edge at all times.
Yeah. I mean, such is life in life.
Wow, that's deep. That's almost Buddhist.
Thanks. Uh-huh.
Such is life in life. That's, I'm going to have to unpack that. I'm going to have to meditate on that for an hour just to understand.
Go for it. Yeah. I think you should.
I'm going to do it. I am. Hey, so what's going on at your work? Just be honest. I mean, just be candid. Just be upfront about it. I mean, stop lying about your work. I mean, just tell me what's really going on.
Don't interrogate me on live podcast. I don't appreciate these methods of information extraction. Nothing really is going on right now. We're still recovering from our security incident. And just busy.
So there hasn't been another security incident since?
No, but I will say that every user is jumping at ghosts. So that's been super fun for me.
Oh, I see. But that's good for you because at least they're alert.
That's what I keep telling myself. Yep.
Well, so how many of them have forgotten their new passwords already?
Fuck, I don't care. A couple, honestly. If you want the real truth, a couple. But it is what it is.
I can tell you love your work. That's the important thing. You love it. You know, I can sense that.
I like it when I get to do the things I like to do, and then there's this aspect of it where I have to do things that nobody likes to do, and you know, that's just been a lot of that lately versus a lot of the beginning. So it is what it is.
I'm so sorry. Well, congratulations on adulting. You're really, really adulting well. Oh, what's happening here? You've muted the microphone. I can see that you're talking. You've got the ear away from you. Something's happening.
I'm back.
She's sick of our shit.
No. Nick disappeared, and so multiple people were looking for him. Yes, we hear you.
Yeah. You're loud and clear.
Okay.
So what happened, first of all, and second of all, how did you fix it?
Okay, my goddamn fucking laptop died. Okay?
Yeah, we heard him sing that. Yeah.
I was just telling Sarah earlier that it does not display, like my laptop doesn't display how much fucking battery is left. It just said, and I've tried, dude. I'm looking all over the goddamn thing. Doesn't tell me, okay? Just doesn't tell me. So I'm like, no big deal. I'll run downstairs, grab my charger, and just plug it in. Oh, but the charger's three prongs, and every fucking outlet in the goddamn room is two prong. So I look for a 3-to-2-prong adapter. Of course, that's none to be found. So then I just run it back downstairs, plug it in, wait for it to fucking charge enough for me to turn it back on, try to fucking find something to clip this bitch on, but I couldn't do it. So
I like your expedient method of just dangling it over your shoulder.
I do like that. You are one with the microphone now.
It's
true.
I would
just like to cut in and say that's my job in a nutshell.
Well, I'm glad we talked about your work. That's important. Hey, Nick, did you end up seeing that Fury Wilder fight last night?
I did, yeah.
So my assessment was that Fury kicked Wilder's ass.
Yeah. He hurt him.
Busted his eardrum.
Yeah, he hurt him bad. I mean, the motherfucker's huge. He's goddamn 7 feet tall. He's like Shrek, the human version of Shrek.
Right. Only more violent.
Yeah.
Considerably more violent.
Yeah, and I watched it, and I was like, this is not, you know, I was like, this is like the top. Don't get me wrong. Those guys are phenomenal, and it was a good fight, but I was like, this will never be as exciting to me as the UFC.
Now, what makes you say that?
Just box, like to stop it, like how they just wrap up on each other and then like the ref will stop it. They just keep getting all these breaks and then they'll fucking like, you know, in UFC, there's no breaks. Like, you know what I mean? Like if you wrap up on each other, then you're, you know, one of you is going to knee the other in the head. You know, there's constant, it's just, there's too much lull in the action in boxing sometimes.
Well, it's the sweet science. Glad it's over. So now have you heard about, we've talked about the Astros sign stealing scandal in the past, but I've heard more about it.
Okay.
And now it looks like there's other teams that we're doing it to.
Oh, okay.
Looks like the Boston Red Sox are going to get some kind of punishment handed down to them.
Okay. And wow, they didn't even win.
So, my question is this. Who gives a shit?
Yeah, who gives a shit? Also, if everyone's doing it, it's like the Tour de France. Like, if everyone's on steroids, then no one's on steroids, you know?
Yeah, so, by the way, should they give Lance Armstrong those titles back, do you think?
Yes. Yeah, for sure. Really? Our roided up guy beat your roided up guy. Everyone was on EPO. So if everyone was on EPO, then you're still all at the same standard. And he was still better than you, you know?
Wow. This is right? unusual. This is an unusual Lance Armstrong defense.
Is that illogical?
Well, no, I feel the same way. You know how I feel. I feel like steroids and performance-enhancing drugs should be mandatory for professional athletes.
Well, I don't think it should be mandatory, but I think it should be a separate league. Like, you can have the juice league and then the all-natural league. But in the juice league, everyone is on steroids. And that way, it's – because the only problem isn't the steroids themselves. It's the deception. You know what I mean? It's the deception of the unfair advantage. But if everyone has the same advantage, it is no longer unfair. You know what I mean? Deceptive or not. So everyone with the same advantage, and our guy still beat yours. So it seems pretty simple what, you know, the answer should be there.
So, son, are you telling me you're on steroids right now? You can be honest.
No, come on, dude. Yeah, I think you would notice.
Well, you have lost some weight, though.
But steroids doesn't make you lose weight.
Well, that's true, but maybe you're on speed instead. I don't know. I mean,
I would be a lot skinnier.
All right. Good point. Very good point. But you have lost some weight. What have you been doing?
Eating less. Well, I've been going to the gym a lot, but not this week. I fucked off this week, actually. But
I'm sorry. Sorry.
You can always just get back.
Get back to it.
Well, I'm going to because I'm paying for the shit. So, yeah. But, yeah, just been eating less. Like, you know, I try to make sure that I'm not eating bad things, and I've found that by not eating bad things, I'm eating a lot less.
Interesting.
Because I was eating mostly bad things.
That's exactly how that works.
Yeah. I can't fucking believe how much fast food I used to eat. Like, at least every day. At least once every day. Sometimes 2-3 times a day, just because.
Yeah.
You know? Just be like, oh, I'm hungry. I'll just eat as much as I want whenever I want.
Well, in fairness, at the time, you were about 120 pounds.
Yeah, I was. And I was still growing. But those times are over.
You're a man now. You're done growing.
Yeah.
Growing tall anyway.
Yeah.
Growing out is always an option.
Yeah, it is an option, but I don't like it. You know?
I understand. Well, I'm impressed that both of you are taking charge of your health.
Yeah. Just eating less is all, for me, anyway.
That's a step in the right direction. You know, next thing you know, you'll quit smoking.
Yeah.
Don't go crazy.
Yeah, I'd like to. I wish there was just like a shot you could get right in your neck and then, oh, you're not addicted to anything anymore. There's something like that in Fallout 4. You can make that. A dick doll or whatever it is. It just cures you of all addictions.
Hmm. Well, wouldn't that be nice? Work on that. Let's just work on it.
Yeah, surely there's got to be a way to do that, right?
Actually, there have been some advances in, for example, for alcohol addiction.
Yeah.
Yeah, and there's also, you know, if you're hooked on heroin, you're not hooked on heroin, are you?
No. I'm way too scared of needles to ever do that. I guess you could smoke heroin.
Yeah, so no, that's
opium.
Good. Oh, good.
Yeah, don't fucks with heroin.
Yeah.
Plan on it, ever.
Have the poppy wars taught us nothing?
No. I mean, I'm not going to lie. You know, opium sounds like it would be fun, but I would never do it.
All right.
I was actually just talking about that, about how, like, heroin is, like, the most relaxed or whatever you could possibly be, but it will also kill you dead.
Heroin's different. Heroin is a processed version of opium.
Yeah, yeah, it's
like a Big Mac to as opposed to actual beef.
So you're saying opium is, you know, all natural, therefore it's better for you.
Relative to heroin, yes.
Well, so we saw, or
but that's
I
not
did.
Really a high bar, you know.
So I saw a fascinating Netflix documentary that I recommend called The Pharmacist.
Yeah, I saw it too.
Yeah, well, I saw.
Well,
it
but you're not the same person,
I saw
though.
It first, so yeah, the I news allowed is... you to watch it after I had seen it.
Yeah, but I also heard that you know, you're not the same person as me.
Yeah, the news is different.
True. Because I saw it first.
Okay, well, she saw it first, and then I went ahead and watched it myself, unknowing that she had already watched it first. Until
no, we talked about it. Anyway.
Fuck. All right. Anyway, so I saw this fucking thing called The Pharmacist, okay? Extraordinary man. Name of Danny something or other. Anyway, this guy was a pharmacist, had a couple of kids, you know, just a normal guy living in St. Bernard Parish, Louisiana.
Are you talking about that skinny dude? He's real skinny, wears the glasses with the brown hair.
No.
Okay,
he's fat.
Never mind.
Yeah, he's
okay.
Obese.
I'm sorry. Continue.
Nice guy though. Anyway, so his son, Danny Jr., gets hooked on crack, unbeknownst to him, goes into the Ninth Ward of New Orleans to make a drug deal, gets shot dead. Okay. So the New Orleans police at that time, which is 1998 or 1999, are so corrupt that they don't even investigate. Okay. So he starts investigating. And guess what? He tracks down the murderer and gets him convicted. How about that? But that's only the beginning, because the guy is a pharmacist. So shortly after that happens, and after he gets justice for his son, he starts noticing an increase in the number of prescriptions that are coming through his pharmacy for oxycodone and for OxyContin. And right. He traces them all to this pill mill that's operating 5 miles down the road. And he starts trying to get the DEA and all that to shut it down. So he recognized the burgeoning opium epidemic
before anyone,
15 years before anybody else did, and was working on getting it stopped, and did get this pill mill shut down. Unbelievable. This guy's incredible.
Yeah, that's a real inspiring story. So
he's
how did
a
he
stalker and kind of weird, but you know, that's
well, you got to be to yeah. take the law into your own hands. So how did he convict, get this guy sent to jail?
Which one? The pill mill doctor?
No, the guy who killed his son.
Well,
how did he investigate and find out who did it? And
he literally canvassed the neighborhood, which was a dangerous proposition. He went to local black churches, enlisted the help of local reverends. And then when none of that turned up anything, he started calling people. He got it's the late 90s. He got a reverse directory and started calling people all around the neighborhood until he found a witness. And then he badgered this witness for the better part of a year until she was willing to talk.
Wow. That's a lot of fucking effort.
Yeah.
Don't know if I would fucking do the same.
This guy was obsessed, man. He was obsessed.
Yeah, he had a bug.
He's so obsessed. He actually took video and or audio recording of almost everything the entire time.
Well, you know what? At least that obsession, almost, shall we say, manic obsession, was channeled and directed to a good thing, you know?
Oh, for sure. And because he recorded damn near everything, it made for a great documentary. Lots of original audio and videos. Amazing.
Yeah, maybe that was his thing the whole time.
Yeah.
Just wanted him for a good documentary. That's
right.
Fucked up.
As soon as my kid dies, documentary.
Documentary time.
Right, time to turn on the recorder. No, he had lots of video of his kids. And, you know, I mean, he had... It was just one of his things that he did, and it turned into something that could. And then when Hurricane Katrina came through, guess where all of his tapes and all of his files were? In his attic. So it was all preserved.
Nice. Serendipitous.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, some would say that he was inspired by the Lord.
Was he? Did he say that?
Yeah.
Did he attribute it all to God, to the Jesusaurus Rex?
Well, I mean, there's a lot of audio of him praying to God, either to relieve him of his obsession or to have him have success.
Yeah. Yeah.
So anyway, The Pharmacist, available on Netflix. It's really easy to watch. It's a 4-part miniseries and definitely 4 or 5 episodes. Definitely worth your time.
Yeah. Well, good.
I can tell you're not going to watch it. That's fine. It's fine.
Yeah. I mean, you kind of gave me the whole rundown.
It does feel exactly like you watched it.
All right, fine. Fuck it. Sorry I gave you too much detail.
It's okay.
No,
no need to apologize.
It saves them 4 hours of their life.
Exactly. Well, you relieve me of having to actually experience it myself.
Well,
I just experienced it vicariously through you, through
you're
the past.
Welcome.
We traveled time. How about that?
We sure did.
What a miracle.
Hey, speaking of which, This podcast is brought to you by the Church of Universal Energy and the Infinite Multiverse. Tired of the dimension in which you're living? No problem. Go ahead and live in another one through the Church of Universal Energy and the Infinite Multiverse. It might not even exist, but it might. All you have to do to find out for sure is send us all your fucking money, care of this podcast.
That's right. All your fucking money. Give Amen. Me all your fucking money. I've been listening to a couple of interesting fellows on the Joe Rogan podcast.
Oh, really?
Yeah. One guy, he's a professor at fucking Brian Greene. Yeah, Brian Greene. Let me just go look at his credentials here. Theoretical physicist, mathematician, and string theorist. Professor at Columbia University since 1996 and chairman of the World Science Festival since co-founding it in 2008.
That what a guy, dumbass.
Yeah, what a dumb.
Brian Greene, huh? Dr. Brian Greene?
Yeah, I can only assume. Yeah. Very interesting things they were talking about. Like the Big Bang. What was happening at the Big Bang, how time works. He had a pretty cool analogy for time. And he said that if someone were walking and they were like, "Can you point me in the direction of north? I want to walk north." You would say, "Okay, it's that way. You go this way. Has to go this way to go north." But if you were at the North Pole and someone would say, "Can you point me in the direction of north? I want to walk north." You would be like, this is where north starts. You can't walk any more north than this.
Any direction from here is south by definition.
Yeah. And he's theoretically, that could be how time works relative to the Big Bang. You know, time is only something that we know exists that we can perceive. And it's just a word for something that
we're saying it's a construct of the mind.
Well, it is, but also it is real though. Like things, you know, that happened in the past are in the past. Like it's just hard to put it into words other than just the one that we have, but there may not have been that before the Big Bang.
Understood. And so in that sense, the arrow of time moves only in one direction.
Yeah, in that context.
Indeed. And so as a result of that, although, for example, when we see light from a star that's 400 light years away, we're seeing something when it hits our eyeballs, it's 400 years old.
Yeah, we're imagining, we're seeing it, as it was, not as it is. I don't think it's possible. Well, it's definitely not possible with the technology we have now to see anything that far away as it is now.
No.
As it is now, it's probably not there anymore, you know? Exploded or whatever the fuck.
It's possible. But let me just say this. Time travel in the future is possible due to the time dilation effect, which is to say that the closer you go to the speed of light, the more time slows relative to where you left. And so more time speeds up back where you left and time slows down the closer you get to the speed of light.
All right.
So if you're close to the speed of light for several years, you come back and 10,000 years will have passed.
How does that work, you know? So is time really so linear, or is it more, I don't know, is there different lanes that run parallel, you know what I mean? You
yes,
know what I'm saying
are. According to the Church of Universal Energy and the Infinite Multiverse, the answer is yes.
Quite.
If you'd like to know more secrets, just go ahead and send me all your fucking money, care of this podcast.
All your motherfucking money.
Every last
matter of fact, place all your valuables in a pile at the front of the building and inchworm out the front face down without making eye contact, and you will attain enlightenment in the due process of time, in the fullness of time.
Right.
Which is relative, as we know, as we all know.
So it could happen to you instantly, or it could take until your death.
Yeah.
We don't know.
What would be the best cause of action for you to take would be to become an astronaut, to get shot into space near some sort of black hole, some kind of event horizon thing that takes you close to the speed of light, so that time, when you come back, it's 10,000 years later, and maybe you will have achieved enlightenment.
Right. Of course, that's going to take a lot of resources, which you've already given to me.
Yeah, but try to accrue more that you can... You know, because we're going to need that.
Oh, we sure will. Sarah, what are your thoughts about the nature of time and space?
Everything's relative, man. It's all made up. The points don't matter. We live in a matrix.
Is that what you truly believe?
I mean, no. I don't know. It's hard to say. It's hard to say if we live in a simulation or not. You know? I mean, truly and honestly, I believe we're here and this is all we got. That's what I deep down believe. But the curious part of me likes to think that we live in a simulation.
I mean, I suppose it's possible. If we ever got to the point where we could create a simulation so similar to our reality that the two were indistinguishable, save that one is on a screen and one isn't, then how could we be sure that we are the original?
Yeah, that's exactly right.
I don't know the answer to that question, but I do know this. This reality, it sure feels pretty fucking real to me.
Yeah, feels real. Feels pretty fucking real. It's pretty convincing, you know?
It sure is.
All I'm saying is that the Matrix apparently made an impact on me as a child.
Yeah, like if it's not real, if whoever the admin is, if they could, like, you know, take joint pain away and debt and, you know, just kind of add a couple of zeros into my bank account.
Well, all of that is just, you know what you've just described?
What?
Prosperity Christianity.
Oh.
Yeah.
Is it really?
Yeah. I mean, basically, Jesus Christ and God are the admins of the simulation that is only running here on Earth before you go to some other, you know, some other real place after the simulation is over.
What would be the point, though?
Well, what's the point right now?
Well, the point right now is that there isn't. If you just think about how many rolls of dice, like, it took, the probabilities of us existing and having this conversation right now, like, there was a one in however many chance that the Earth would be formed this size, this distance from the Earth, that it would have the appropriate amount of chemicals that could coalesce into some sort of single cell organism that would somehow, over time, just the dice keeps getting rolled and falling on the perfect fucking head, on the perfect side, so that these things culminate into us even knowing what that could have happened at all. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, I do, because you can go all the way back and say, hey, if our universe had different values, life would be completely impossible.
Right. Yeah. Or even if the Earth had been farther away from the sun or whatever, an infinite number of factors that could have completely changed or eliminated life as we know it.
Yeah, that's true.
So that to me is awesome enough that I don't need to go searching for the purpose in it all. It's just so incredible that it's even, that the chances kept piling up that it's even to this point at all, that, you know, that's it. That's the purpose. That's the answer to the question, is that it's such a crazy, you know, chance that you're even here to ask that fucking question that you should just enjoy it while you can.
Well, so here's the point about all that, right? Which is this. What you're describing, Nicholas, the infinitesimal odds that we're here at all, this is another reason why there are people of faith who believe that there must be a guiding intelligence to have made this all possible.
That makes sense. I could see why you would go that direction with it. You could say that. And there might be, you know, there might be something that we don't that we could never comprehend at our current state. We could be a science experiment. There's any number of things, you know, any number of reasons. But even if there is no reason and it just fucking happened on chance after chance after chance, that's impressive enough, you know?
Oh, certainly.
And if it's not, if there is some sort of almighty, so what capacity is the almighty creator interested? And, you know, do people really believe that because they think it's impossible for it to happen? Or do they believe that because they're scared of dying? Because they don't really want to die. They want to live forever in the clouds with their old friends and family.
Well, who wouldn't want that, right?
Well, of course, I would love that. That would be so fucking awesome. That's the only reason that I would ever want any of that to be real, just to see people who are gone. You know what I mean? But, you know, like, if we're based on what we know, which admittedly isn't much, you know, when you think about it, like, there might be senses. There are things that happen all around us that you don't know are happening, but they are real. They're tangible things with real consequences and effects that we just might not be able to perceive.
Like what?
For instance, just the air around you all the time. Oh, the air is moving. The composition of the air changes. Sometimes it gets harder to breathe. If there's this chemical, that chemical, it's like, you know, certain, it's only because that we have, and certain smells, like only because we have a nose, do we even know that smells exist? Yeah, what other things are like that, that we just don't possess the sense or the organ to perceive? You know what I mean?
Like the mantis shrimp seeing more colors than
exactly.
we can.
Exactly. Yes. Yeah.
Or, for example, wouldn't it be great if your nose didn't smell farts?
That would be great. But on a serious note, the mantis shrimp thing is, it's still sight. It's a level of sight, a magnitude of sight that we couldn't comprehend because it's so much more advanced. I'm talking about a completely different... You know, there's certain fish, don't ask me to name them off the top of my head because I'm a dumbass, that have...
Let's just say bluegill.
No, they're like deep sea fish that, like, they don't see... They have, like, these organs that we don't fully understand, like these perceptive organs. You know, they can sense things, and we don't have that. You know what I mean? Well, could there be some other sensory thing? Like, we know the five senses. Is there another one that we just can't perceive because we don't have the equipment? You know
undoubtedly.
What I mean?
I mean, take a look at the electromagnetic spectrum. There's plenty in the electromagnetic spectrum that we can't detect because our eyeballs are so limited.
Radio waves.
We
you
can't
know what
see
I mean?
Infrared and so
yeah.
on.
Yeah. But that's all, but still, that's all sight, though. You know what I mean? We're still relating this to one sense. I'm talking about a sense that you don't have, that is unlike any other, can't be compared. You know what I mean?
We can't describe it. But let me give you another
example.
And
if there is,
yeah.
You go ahead.
I was just going to say, I understand what you're saying. There's a whole dimension of reality that we can't perceive.
And what resides in that dimension? If we can't perceive, you don't know what you don't know. You know what I mean?
What resides in that sense that we can't sense is perhaps the spirits of the undead, of the spirits of the dead, perhaps, or who knows, you know, or aliens themselves. Maybe they reside in a place that we can't perceive.
Or just other things, like living creatures, just not living in the sense that we understand it. Because it's just, you know, just because you don't know, like people say, well, that's not scientifically possible. There's no way that there could be any other kind of life aside from carbon-based life because we understand science to this degree, we know. And I'm like, well, but do you really know? Like, do you really understand it all? Like, like I said, you don't know what you don't know. There's no way for you to know what you don't know. Yeah, so
let me give you another example. So here's another.
Let me tell you what I do know.
What do you know?
I'm getting bored of this.
Dude, me too. I'm ready to be out.
I tire of this line of thinking.
All right. So here's the last thing, which is that a dog like Moose can smell a million different things, right? I mean, dogs can smell literally a million times more and better than we do, except of course for Moose, because he's a 3-pack-a-day dog. And so he's burned out his nose.
Grizzly bears actually have better sense of smell than dogs, but yeah.
Really?
Yeah. I've read that a grizzly bear can smell a deer's corpse underwater from 18 miles away.
Well, here's what I would say to that. Why don't we train grizzly bears then to be bomb sniffing bears?
I'm pretty sure a dude tried to do that, like tried to be cool with grizzly bears, and it did not fucking go well.
Well, yeah, he got eaten.
Dude, someone told me, is Bear Grylls dead?
No, he's not.
Someone fucking told me he died. Like, I'm like, come on, man. I'm pretty sure I would know. Like, that would be in the news.
Yeah. Bear Grylls is not dead.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah, so I don't know if it was real, but it sounded real. But I heard the recording. Well, I could only stand it for like 30 seconds of that. Because, you know, the bear man who got him and his girlfriend eaten by grizzly bears.
Which was not Bear Grylls, to be clear.
No, this was a whole different guy.
Yeah.
But he had a fucking camera recording while it was happening. So there's audio of it, and I listened to it, and it was predictably horrifying.
So here's a pro tip, right? If you're listening to a bear eat a human being, you're going to be grossed out. But you know when you're not going to be grossed out? When you head on down to Ziff's. That's right, Ziff's. Fine dining and a relaxed continental atmosphere right down there in Invercargill, New Zealand. You're going to want to get on down there. It's the southernmost restaurant in the southern hemisphere, which means it's probably the southernmost restaurant in the world. And that means one thing, freshly slain kiwi juice. And while you can get them, your koala tendies. Mmm, so tasty. Right there at Ziff's, proud fake sponsor of a Shin Show for more than a billionth of a millennium, your time permitting.
You could say more than 100 billionths of a century and still definitely be correct.
That's true. to say nothing of a millennium.
Also, you know, I'm going to say, let's just say, you know, southernmost restaurant in the known world. There could be some uncontacted tribes on some islands that are uncharted that could have some sort of local eatery.
Right.
Not a restaurant as such. Definitely not passing any inspections or anything like that. I don't know if there's like a manager and, you know, anything like that. But there's probably like a central, like a mess hall. Yeah. If you will.
Yeah, sure, probably. Or who knows what we can't even see with the naked eye or perceive through our sense of smell.
Yeah, there might be some sort of supernatural, ghostly,
right,
you know.
Ethereal restaurant, yeah.
Ethereal ice cream shop or something.
Yeah, or you can just go to Ziff's. All right, so.
Yeah, Ziff's is probably easier to find.
Yeah, so Sarah, but not much because it's in the southern island of New Zealand. You're going to have to, you know, really kind of try and get there. So, Sarah, I know you were bored with all this chat about the...
What, how does that bore you? How does the thought of an extra-dimensional reality coterminous with ours bore you?
It's super cool, but it's also so abstract and not applicable that...
Not applicable.
Eventually, I tire of it. Not applicable to my day-to-day.
Well, I mean... It could be, though. It definitely could be applicable to your day-to-day.
But it's not.
Well, right. Why isn't it, though? Because you choose to make it
because
not
I live
part
in this,
of your...
this dimension, and we don't have the technology to explore any other dimensions, nor will we in our lifetime.
Well, I mean, isn't it safe to say that it could be that if you... you know what? I don't know. Fuck it. Let's move on.
He has spoken. All right. So, moving on. I think it's actually time to wrap up. What do you guys got going on this week? Anything of interest?
Yeah, we're going to see you, dude.
Oh yeah, that's right.
yeah. I forgot that, too.
Yeah, that reminds me. I got to get a hotel.
Well, you don't have to. You can sleep in my house, dude, in my apartment. Of course you can. It's not going to, a hotel will be physically more comfortable, but will the
you
hospitality
won't have a cat
be there?
Attacking you.
Yeah, and you won't have a cat scraping your eyes out of your fucking skull, but the hospitaliano. You know,
right.
That can't be bought.
No, especially since both you and Taylor at one time worked at Olive Garden. So
yeah.
Therefore, the hospitaliano,
it's ingrained.
Legit.
It's ingrained in us. You know, we scrub, but it doesn't come off. You know
right.
What I'm saying?
Well, that explains the hospitaliano tattoos that both of you
one
have.
One word, Ben fucking Venuto.
Motherfucking welcome. Yeah, man. All right, so we'll determine.
Yeah, so you're the big news. You're the fucking...
I'm the big news.
But and obviously we can work out the logistics not on the podcast, but you can stay at my apartment. You don't have to get a hotel.
All right, I appreciate
that. Although if
that.
You do want to get a hotel, Taylor's mom works for Marriott. She can save you $10.
Yeah.
Right, can get you a very minor discount.
Very minor, but it is still a discount.
Yes. I think I'm going to use my points and stay at a Holiday Inn Express. That'll
okay,
make me
too
smarter,
good for
too.
The Marriott. That's all good.
No, I'm not too good for
too
it.
Too good for my gifts. Okay.
I can
no.
I can
he just already belongs.
You. No, I can get the free 99, though. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, and also, your sleeping situation. I got a pull-out fucking bed in my goddamn 1995
you are not
corduroy
selling this
couch.
At all, dude.
I just don't want you to feel obligated to stay, but I don't want you to think that I don't. You could stay anywhere I'm staying, bro, but you're kind of a distinguished grown man, you know?
Distinguished, yes.
Here's
well,
the thing. The less money you spend on hotel, the more money you can spend on y'all for birthdays. So you really got to work on how you're selling this.
Yeah, here's the point. And the point is this.
You
and I have stayed together when it was you in a basement and we shared a king-size bed.
Oh, we did. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, dude, you can totally stay at my house. And we don't have to even share the bed. You can have.
But you can.
But can we?
Well, you can. Well, I'll have to ask Taylor about that. But you can, you know, you can definitely use the pullout bed.
That would not be weird for her.
Are you trying? Are you trying to relive your bachelor days?
No, but yeah, you can. You can. You are more than welcome. If you don't want to spend the money, you can stay at my house for my
okay,
apartment.
Appreciate that.
He just said free 99 with points. I heard him.
Yeah.
Okay, don't think I didn't hear that.
Yeah. Hey, Taylor, scooch over.
I'll get y'all matching pajamas. It'll be adorable.
Oh, yeah, we can get matching onesies.
Union suits, if you will.
Oh, like a Siamese, a three-person Siamese onesie.
Oh, my God. Taylor, I'm so sorry.
But with one ass flap.
Taylor, I have excellent news. You are going to love this. I went ahead and pulled the trigger already, so don't even worry. Well, I made the $500 deposit on the Siamese three-person onesie, and that's non-refundable, so this is not really a, you know, a question.
Just a notification, really, more than anything. Anyway, so I'm looking forward to that, obviously. And, hey, one bit of quick good news. I'm going to bring Chris with me. Elsie can't make it, but I'm just going to bring Chris, our one listener. So he can be on the pod.
Sounds
weird. Yeah, it does. I'm just kidding. Chris isn't coming.
Oh, really? He's not?
No.
That would be weird. That'd be very weird. That would make me uncomfortable, to be honest. I don't know, Chris, and he sounds like a shifty motherfucker, to be honest.
From, right?
Just from what you've told me, Dad, in our private conversations off the podcast, you know the ones where you're like, don't ever mention this, but that Chris dude, man, he's just fucking always talking to me and fucking his eyes are always darting around the place. Fucking weirdo. And I was like, yeah, of course. I know you're telling me this in confidence, so I would never like
I would share it on a podcast.
Yeah,
no.
Yeah.
But it's funny because it's not true. This seems a straight arrow. Good man. Terrific human being. And the only fucking person who listens to this fucking podcast.
I was going to say, again, pandering to our listener.
Yeah. I'll pander to him all day long because he listens.
Yeah, that's right. And provides feedback. All right. So anyway, well, I look forward to seeing you later on this week. And, you know, good to talk to you, kids.
Yes, it was good to talk to you as well.
All right. Bye-bye, Elsie.
Bye-bye.
All right. Love you. Bye.
Bye, bye, bye.
Bye, bye, bye.